Hi, I'm Dr. Philip McMillan, and thank you for joining me if you're taking a look at this next headline, COVID vaccines and autoimmune explosion. What am I talking about and why is this even relevant, as some people perceive that the pandemic is over? Well, if you've been following my research, I've always been speaking about autoimmunity in the context of COVID-19. That's been the basis of my research since March 2020. So a lot of what I say may be sometimes a year or even 2 years ahead of mainstream scientific thinking. And this is why I keep you up to date on what exactly is happening. So I'll first remind you as to what I had said easily on March 2020 or April 2020, and we published our paper initially in June 2020, and then a further one in July 2021. And it was a simple point. All we had said is that here is a spike protein, which is in blue and green. This here is the spike protein. And we had said that the free ACE2, which is a protein that the virus uses to enter the cell. So when it's attached to the cell, it binds to the spike protein and it allows the virus to enter the cell. So this is just a spike protein, and you can imagine virus is attached here. But in the same way, the vaccine spike protein binds to ACE2. And that's how they knew that it worked, because it was binding similarly as the viral spike protein. And essentially, the question we had asked in relation to the risk of autoimmunity is, if this free spike, free ACE2 binds to the spike protein, will it then lead to an autoimmune response? And that was our research about the autoimmune response in severe COVID-19. And therefore, if it can occur in, say, severe COVID-19 regarding the spike protein, why would not autoimmunity occur as well in the context of the vaccine spike protein? And in August 2022, I shared this preprint, which for some reason is still not fully published yet, but it was about a potential autoimmune explosion in the context of 20% of the vaccinated cohort. And it was a small study in Italy at the time, but extremely significant and very relevant to what I expect to happen. And so in that context, you have a situation where autoimmunity is only now just starting to be recognized as being very relevant in the context of severe COVID-19 and potentially vaccine-related conditions. So what is this all about? And it came from an important piece of information that was shared that I saw. So I always give credit to people who have shared it. And this is from a Substack for Alexander COVID News, Dr. Paul Elias, Japanese evidence of immune system thyroid dysfunction by Pfizer COVID injection, disruption of thyroid autoimmunity. And so immediately when I saw this, it fits right in with the research that I've been talking about. I thought, I've got to take a look at this paper and try and understand a little bit more about what they were doing. And so that's essentially what I'm going to do. I'm going to take you a little bit through the paper and then give you the clinical relevance as to what exactly this means going forward for populations who are highly vaccinated. It's important to understand that this research is not a definitive that this is going to happen, but it's an extrapolation of everything that I've seen around autoimmunity. And very often an individual person will say, oh my goodness, does that mean I'll end up with an autoimmune disease? No, risk is small, small percentages. So the individual risk may be small, but across a population where you have a million people, even a 0.01% risk raises the numbers of patients in that region and across the countries. That's why it's relevant, because it has an impact on service delivery. And so we have to be aware of it. So let's get back to the research. What were these Japanese people doing? They were looking at a study. So this was published on the 27th of January, 2023. So that's just a few weeks ago. And they were looking at the effect of SARS-CoV-2 BNT162b2 mRNA vaccines on thyroid autoimmunity, a 12-month follow-up study. And that's very, very important. The critical thing there is that the duration of the study is extremely important. And I'm going to come back to that in a little bit. But why were they doing this in the first place? And you can see here, when I get back to this, they were doing this study because they found that Graves' disease had been highlighted as a possible adverse effect of the COVID vaccine. So essentially, they were noticing that Graves' disease, and Graves' disease is an autoimmune disease that involves the thyroid gland, where antibodies against specific proteins in around the thyroid gland produce an excessive thyroid response, and then you have a big thyroid. And sometimes people can need some surgery to take it out, or it can produce a lot of thyroid hormones, and they can have thyrotoxicosis. And we have to use various techniques to try and bring down the amount of thyroid hormones in their body. So Graves' disease is well known. And so the question that they were looking at in Japan was, they were seeing an increased risk of it. Could this be related to vaccination? And so that's what they then set about to do. They set about to look at it. Now, isn't that good? Why is it that more people or more scientists are not looking at these questions? Now, even though it was a bit late, this is now 2023, we're 2 years down the line from instituting the vaccination program, you would have thought we should have had most of these answers within a year. That would be ideal. Sometimes research takes a bit of time, but I would have thought it would have been incumbent on the regulators and the industry companies to be doing this research in parallel as we had a rollout with regards to vaccination. That would have been the ideal. So getting back to the paper, what they did is that they then got 99 healthcare workers. I'll pull this down here so you can see. They included 99 healthcare workers, all part of one Wakayama City Medical Association. And they were then looking at the response at time zero, time one, about 4 weeks after the second vaccination, and then pre the third booster dose, and then after the booster dose. So it was an important strategy with regards to what they were looking at. And here you can see, this is the image in terms of them looking at IgG titers, that's against the vaccine. This would have been 0.0, and then this would have been 4 weeks after the second dose, second vaccine. And then this is pre the third vaccine, and then the antibody dose after that. So this was just standard looking over a period of time at what had happened. And what were the outcomes, I guess, is really the question. And this is where it comes down to the autoimmune response. And what they found, and this is the most important bit, is essentially that when they looked at the thyroid antibody, this is the autoantibody that stimulates the thyroid gland, causing thyrotoxicosis and Graves' disease, they saw a stepwise increase over 12 months. This is 32 weeks pre the third vaccine. This is the baseline. So it's higher here, and then it goes up even higher at this point. So you can see a progressive rise in this autoantibody response after vaccination. And it's paralleled by a very gradual fall in the thyroid stimulating hormone, which as the gland starts to produce more thyroxine, you then end up with that kind of hyperactivity of the thyroid gland. And so that's very, very important. Because as I said, oftentimes what we look at in medicine is small changes. Somebody has a risk for something, and an intervention can reduce that risk to make it occur earlier or in a more severe fashion than what had occurred before. And that's the kind of thing that we should be looking for. Now, you may have many people who are against this kind of information, and they will say, no, that doesn't mean that this is a problem. We've looked at this before, and we haven't seen any issues. And they're right. They did do some studies previously, and this is a study that was done in 2022, looking at the effect of the Pfizer vaccine on antinuclear antibody and antiphospholipid antibody levels. And what they essentially said in this paper here is that they did not find any significant difference between the two. And the benefits of the BN2 vaccine significantly outweigh any possible autoimmune dysregulation considering the current evidence. It was a small study that they were looking at here. And critically, that study that they would use as reassurance only looked at 2 points, which is 4 weeks after the first and a month, 33 days after the second dose. And therefore, that's compared to what happened in Japan, where they were looking at 12 months. This is why I said the duration of the study is extremely important when we look at it. And that leads me to the Substack post that I did in August 2022. And this one here was about that looming autoimmune explosion. And in this post, what I was focused on is that mRNA vaccines may trigger autoimmunity in up to 20% of recipients. And what was this based on? It was based on a preprint. So the evidence of the presence of antinuclear antibodies in healthcare workers, and this was in Italy. And I found that this was an extremely important paper. I reached out to the author, and she shared with me just the front bit as to the summary, the abstract. And this is effectively what it was saying. So again, I'll take you through this here so that you understand the importance of this research that still hasn't been fully published, but is extremely relevant. So here you have this study. They took, at this point, 108 participants. These were all healthcare workers. And they looked at them at time zero, 1 month after, and 12 months after. And effectively, again, they found a significant rise in autoantibodies, ANAs, antinuclear antibodies. That's what we see in many autoimmune diseases. But similar to what we saw in the second study, they found that there was only a slight increase after 1 month, but a significant increase after 12 months. And that's where the increase of 20% that came from. And their conclusion was that the vaccine seems as though it could cause significant changes in autoimmunity, which is new autoimmunity, in people who didn't have it, as well as increasing autoimmunity in the baseline population. These are extremely important pieces of information, and it requires us to actually study it in detail. Now, this is why I've always been cautious whenever I hear that term, safe and effective. I'm saying, but we haven't done long-term studies yet. We don't know the unintended consequences of some of our interventions. And as has been said on many occasions by people who are experienced in vaccine development, Jennifer Smith, you know, Gert van den Vos, identifying some of these patterns take time. And this is why oftentimes, generally, bringing out a new vaccine takes 5 to 10 years. And so in the context of the pandemic, they had to do something. I will give credit for that. But I think that it was an overstep of the science to reassure people that there were no problems. What they meant when they said safe and effective was that there was no evidence of a problem. But of course, there can be no evidence of a problem if there is no research. And as you can see, research takes time. So we are only now at the 2-year mark starting to see some of that research coming out, which is highlighting that autoimmune response. This is relevant. And as I said, in the context of an individual risk, that's small. Well, we assume it's small. But in the context of population risk and the impact that it can have on a population of millions of people, then that is huge when it comes to health service delivery. Because if you see even a 3% increase in cases of Graves' disease across the country, that's a lot of patients. That means more pressure on the system, less resources, more doctors are needed, more lab systems are needed, more monitoring, more drugs. And so this has a knock-on effect when we have to think about autoimmune diseases. So this is why I said, when it comes back to the basics of the science has always been, is severe COVID-19 an autoimmune disease? Based on our research, we absolutely said yes. It takes time for the scientific community to understand this. And that's why I said what you're hearing here is sometimes a year to 2 years ahead of what you will hear anywhere else. But I am absolutely sure that autoimmunity is central in the context of COVID-19. We can argue about which proteins are involved. But as long as you understand that autoimmunity is likely to increase across the population, that will help you to know, therefore, where we need to target our research. That's the call now to the clinicians and to the researchers. Now that we're starting to see this, what do we use this information for to prepare for the future? And believe me, there's a long road ahead and still a lot of work to do. Thank you for joining me. I hope you found this valuable. And please join me on Substack if you want to see that research a year ahead of everybody else. Have a great day.